baptism is. Baptism is done for the forgiveness of sins, Acts 2:38. Baptism is done to save us, 1 Peter 3:21, Acts 2:40, Mark 16:16. Baptism is done to wash away our sins, Acts 22:16. Baptism is done to be reborn to new life, John 3:5, Romans 6:3-6. Baptism is done to clothe ourselves with Christ, Galatians 3:26 and 27.
Trust in the Lord with all your hearts, and lean not into your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path.
And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amoz, came unto him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, Set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. May I tell you that hearing from God is not always nice? Oh, I wish the Lord had talked to me. You're going to die this afternoon. He said, Set thy house in order, thou shalt die and not live. And then Hezekiah turned his face toward the wall and prayed unto the Lord. And he said, Remember now, O Lord, I beseech thee, how I've walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart. Now, you got to get this. He didn't say he was perfect. He said his heart was perfect, which means his desires were perfect, but his performance was always lackluster. That's why the Lord said, Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Doesn't mean you're righteous. It means you hunger to be righteous. For they shall be filled. Thou shalt die and not live. He turned his face to the wall. He said, I walk before thee in truth and a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. Then came the word of the Lord to Isaiah, saying, Go and say to Hezekiah, Thus saith the Lord, the God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayer, I've seen thy tears. And I'll add unto thee 15 years, and I'll deliver the city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city. Verse 20, and the Lord was ready to save me. I want to talk to you about turning impossible situations around. You can do it. Turning impossible situations around. It is so easy for you and I to stand at the place of seemingly impossibility and get frustrated by it to the point that we lose our faith and we get a hold of fear. Nobody likes things that are impossible. So this morning, we need to believe that the Lord is still in the healing business, the delivering business, the saving business, the filling with the Holy Ghost business. And that nothing is too hard for the Lord. When Paul did the apostolic autopsy, Romans chapter 1, and he gives that litany of things of immorality, of being licentious, about being perverted, sick, terrible. All that stuff follows on the heels of one word, and neither were they thankful. Once he said a generation gets to the place that they're not thankful, here comes homosexuality, here comes lesbianism, here comes perversion, here comes lying and cheating and dishonesty and evil and wickedness. That stuff doesn't just show up. You stay thankful to God and you're unbeatable. I don't care what kind of hell and crisis and chaos you are facing. You stay thankful to God. And can't no devil take you out. Can't no situation make you bitter and sour if you can stay thankful. America, that is the curse and the tragedy that's happened to our nation. We have raised a generation of kids and even adults now that are not thankful. Gripe and complain about everything, never have enough, don't have this, don't have that. The reason why you find Satan never coming back to Job's farm. He's on Job's farm, chapter 1 and chapter 2. For the next 40 chapters, you don't see that dirtbag. He don't ever show up. You want to know why? He don't know how to handle somebody that's thankful when it's bad. If you can remember one, remember this. Hell's after your song. Hell's after your joy. Hell's after your thankfulness. If he can steal your thankfulness, he can manipulate me and thee any way he wants to go. But you give me somebody that is thankful with tears coming down their face, that is thankful when they had to bury a loved one, when they stay thankful and they've lost their job, when they've lost their home, when they don't know what to do. You show me somebody that's thankful and he'll drive hell crazy. He doesn't know what to do with someone who stays thankful when it doesn't make any sense. Satan challenged the Lord and said, where you been? He said, oh, I've been walking to and fro on the earth, trying to cause every mess I could. And I can see the Lord just smile at him and said, really? He said, have you considered my servant Job? And I can see Satan said, have I considered him? I can't get to the bum. I try to get there. You got this fence around him. You bless everything that he's got. No wonder he loves you. No wonder he worships you. I can't get to him. You won't let me touch him. Don't ever believe that hell's got access to a saint of God's life at will. He's got to get permission to touch you. He's got to get God's permission to mess with you. And if he messes with you, it's because God says, you're bigger than him. You're greater than him. You're going to survive. You're not going to be destroyed. You're going to be developed. He says, have you considered my servant? He goes, yeah, I've been trying to get to his farm. You won't let me on there. And watch what he says. But he said, you know, just take his stuff. Just take his stuff and he'll curse you to your face. Now watch. Now this is in my mind. I can see the Lord going, looking at Job, looking at stupid. Now I call him stupid. He threw him out at 186,000 miles per second. Fired him. Now God goes looking for a replacement. So what does he do? He gets the thing nearest to nothing, dust and dirt, and he makes a mud ball and breathes into it. He said, you're in charge of music. And he gives us the song of the Lord, and he gives us the joy of the Lord, and he lets us make melody unto God in our hearts. And every time you sing and you clap and you rejoice and you say, thank you, Jesus, it drives your adversary crazy, because we were nothing like him. We were the lowest on the totem pole. But by the grace of God, we have been exalted so that now we are the praisers and the worshipers of the Almighty. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall be continually in my mouth. I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. I will be thankful and bless his name. If you can learn to be thankful, you are unbeatable. You just be thankful. Paul said, neither were they thankful. He wiped them out and took all his stuff. You know what the adversary thinks you're made of? Your stuff. Let me ask you something. Can God let you lose your stuff and you still keep your song? Watch. If God allows you to lose your stuff, will you still praise him? I have people that I've pastored when they have a bunch of hell break loose and they lose their stuff and they lose their job. I don't even see them at church for weeks. What happened to you? Well, I got fired. I lost this. I lost that. Yeah, but God didn't fall off his throne. What's the problem? Do you actually think because you lost your stuff, he lost his scepter? You don't know that he's still all-wise, almighty? That he's still the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the ending, the first, the last, the Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, the Bride of the Morning Star, the Root and the Offspring of David, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, Master of the Universe, Sustainer of all life, the Highest and Holiest Potentate. You ready? And he's on your side. And if God be for you, it doesn't matter who or what is against you. You can make it. And I preached a message. Can God trust you with trouble? Because the adversary comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. And I said, can God trust you with trouble? Or will you be sucking your thumb? Pentecostal pity party. How come you're not praising? I can't praise and suck my thumb at the same time. And some of God's greatest people have had problems sucking their thumb. Ask Elijah. He's under a juniper tree running away from that old bag. That old bag didn't have an army, didn't have swords, didn't have chariots. You know what she did? She drove him out of town with her word. Because words produce pictures, and pictures produce feelings, and feelings produce actions, and actions produce destinies. And all that old bag said was, I heard you called my preacher. And I heard you made my old man look like a fool with all your little magic tricks up there. I don't know how you did it, but I'm unimpressed. And about this time tomorrow, I'm going to make you like one of them. I'm going to cut your nasty head off. Love, Jez. Now watch this. All he got was some words from an old bag. An old bag. Don't you believe that when hell threatens you, it can do what it wants to do? It's got to have permission. Hell can't just barge into your house and kill your kids and ruin your marriage. He ain't got that much authority or his power. Even though he's been fired, he's the Lord of glory. And he determines what's going to happen and what's going to be allowed. You got to hear me. If God can trust you with trouble, don't get wiped out when trouble comes, because through trouble, we're going to honor him and we're going to magnify him and we're going to glorify him and we're going to show the world that Satan is not the big windbag that he says he is. Next day, I'm reading my Bible in a restaurant. I'm sitting there and it goes, zzz, that was it. Had a massive stroke. Strokes, I said, I know about trouble. You ready for this? Jesus is greater than my trouble. Jesus is greater than your trouble. Jesus is greater than your problems. Jesus is greater than any lying devil that could ever mess with your life. I do this for a living, and now I can't preach, I can't write, I can't see, and I don't know what's going to happen. Bad things are allowed of God. They're ordained. Now, you may not believe bad things are, but they are. They are. He doesn't start them. He just allows them. And I don't know what's going on, so I'm praying, God, I have no problem with the stroke, but I would like for you to tell me why it's happening, what's wrong. What are you trying to teach me? Don't ever waste your storm. Don't ever waste your crisis. Don't ever waste the negative thing that happens in your life. That's shameful. There's a purpose in all things. He's the master instructor. He's the master teacher. And I pray and I pray and I pray and I can't get any direction. So I go to this cardiologist. I'm not boring you, am I? I mean, because I don't know about silence. I can't function with silence. And so I go to this cardiologist. He said, we can't figure out what caused your blood pressure to spike. And let me just check your carotid artery. Now, he just did the thing. And he goes, well, what in the world? That can't be right. How do you feel? I said, I feel great. He says, that's unbelievable. He puts it on my back. He says, your pulse is 180. You just had an increase of 300 beats in your pulse. He said, your heart's fixing to explode right now. Nothing's changed. I'm just sitting there. He says, don't get off that seat. I'm going to do an EKG on you right now. He comes in, he gives you little wires, puts all that stuff on, takes 5 minutes, comes back in, he says, you totally failed. I know what caused your stroke in Colombia, and I know what caused your stroke now. I said, well, lay it on me, because I'm tired of being a car dealer. Tell me what it is. And he said, you are suffering from atrial fibrillation. He said, well, your heart's got two chambers, and it does like this. But right now, the top chamber of your heart's going, he's shaking like a bowl of jello. That's called fibrillation. What happens is the vessel that's in between the bottom and top chamber, that blood coagulates. It becomes like molasses, like glue. Then when you go out of fibrillation and your heart goes back to pumping, it pushed that sludge down out of your heart and pushed it to the back of your brain. It was too thick. It couldn't get in. So all those cells died. I said, wow. I said, well, thank you, doc. He said, so he tells me, he says, we can treat your AFib and you'll be okay and you won't have any more strokes. So I go home and I'm in the room and I'm just praying and I'm thanking God that they found out what was wrong with me so I could get some help. Thank you, Jesus. And the Lord speaks to me and it thundered in my head and he said, your brother Richard. I said, my brother Richard? 10 years ago, I found my brother dead in his house and I preached his funeral and buried him. And I just answered, I'm as dumb as anything. I said, what about my brother Richard? And the voice said, what did he die of? Well, I had to do an autopsy because I found him dead in his house. And I said, lethal arrhythmia. And the voice said, and that's exactly where you were going. And neither you nor the medical field knew what was wrong with you. Watch this. So I allowed you to have this stroke so it could be discovered, so you could be delivered, because you have a destiny. You got to learn to understand, in every problem, there is a possibility. There is a discovery that can be made. You can be blessed and helped by it. Now, that hasn't done for you what it's done for me. But now I realize God's not finished with me yet. And God's not finished with a lot of you yet either. Ain't nobody and nothing can take you out until God's finished with you. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. Nothing. He can do everything. Nothing is impossible to him. Ask Abraham and Sarah, 99 and 90. And God shows up and said, baby time. That was Sarah had ceased to be with her after the manner of a woman. Her body would not cooperate except when the God of the impossible shows up. He turns around and says, Abe, let's go take a walk. See, a lot of times when God wants to show you something, he's got to get you away from people. And he took him out and gives him that story, the stars of the sky and the sand by the seashore. I've often wondered, I said, Lord, why did you say, well, count the stars if you can, count the grain of sands. Real easy. He said, I want you to know that my promise works in the dark and the light. It works in the night and the daytime. So when you're discouraged, look up at the stars. When you're in this time during the day, try to count the sand. That's how faithful I am. You got to hear me. God is faithful to you. He will not lie to you. He will not deceive you. He will not frustrate you. And I can just see when he just kind of puts his arm around Abe. He says, now, Abe, I'm going to start a nation out of you and Sarah. And next year about this time, Sarah's going to have a little bambino, going to have a little bubala. And can you see Abraham? Said, Lord, in case you haven't noticed, when my wife and I retire for the night, we just shake hands. We play Uno. I mean, we've been married so long, when we go to bed at night, we just say, see ya. I think I've made my point. I can see Abraham after the Lord said, you're going to be a daddy and Sarah's going to be a mama. Now, remember, he went out talking with God like this. After he got the promise, he said, zippity-doo-da, zippity. My, oh my, what a wonderful day. Now, I know it's humorous, but I'll tell you what. If God can give a 99-year-old man a baby, he can give new life to you. He can make a way where there is no way. He can turn your situation around. I don't care how impossible it may feel, look, or seem. He is the Lord of the impossible, and nothing is impossible to him. There's a miracle heading your way right now if you can believe him for the impossible. Isaiah gave Hezekiah most terrible news. You're not going to live. You're going to die. And the Bible says when Hezekiah received that news, he turned his face to the wall. That's why I felt the Lord dealt with me this morning in prayer. Some of my people need to turn their face away from bad news. Turn their face away from bad circumstances. Turn their face away from things. God said, you're not going to live, you're going to die. And like so many of us Pentecostals, he could have just said, oh, well. He turned around and he said, I ain't ready to die. I got some living to do. I got some things I want to do for God. But he turned around, the Bible said, he turned his face to the wall. Why? Because if you turn your face to the wall, you can't see anything but God. Too many of us are studying our problems. Too many of us are listening to people's voices and opinions. We got to shake loose of that stuff. If God said it, it's going to happen. If God promised, it's going to be. He cannot lie. He is the master of the universe. He is able to touch anybody. He is able to forgive anybody. He is able to save anybody. If you can believe. The disciples tried to cast the devil out of that father's boy, and they failed. But on the heels of failure, the Lord stepped up and said, I'll take care of it. See, too many of us allow failures in our lives to become final. Sometimes you got to fall to fly. When that little mama throws those little chicklets, those little baby eaglets out of that nest, and they start tumbling and falling, it's only the fall that taught them how to fly. On the way down, they, oh, these things that they never used before. You got stuff that you can fly with, but you ain't used it. You ain't been in enough trouble. I tell our church family all the time, hey, we need revival. Let's play for trouble. I can't even get a burp or an amen from our group. I don't want no more trouble. Well, trouble is where you triumph. Trouble is where you learn. Trouble is where you grow. Trouble is where you get your testimony. You can't have a testimony without a test. So we sing that song, he brought me out of the miry clay. You and I, we want to be brought out, but no clay. I just want to go from here to glory, pristine. I said, oh, Lord, make me like the disciples. Are you sure? Hell and trouble and jail and beating and blasphemy and mistreatment and ungodly things happen to him? I want to be used by God. Oh, that means you have to be abused. I'm not a sadist. I'm not one of those crazy people dressed in black with a whip and all that foolishness, a masochist. I don't enjoy problems and issues and pain. But if that's what it takes for me to learn, fine. Because God's got his hand on the throttle. Nebuchadnezzar doesn't have his hand on the thermostat. We love the story of Job. Why? Because of all the hell he went through. We get strength right now from the book of Job because of all the hell he went through. And the sadness he went through. And the sickness he went through. And the misunderstanding. But I'll tell you what, I hope to God I never have three friends like Job. If that's friends, I don't want enemies. They damned to condemn that guy and ridicule him and told him it must be sin, you're not living right and all that stuff. Had to put up with all that trash. And then finally the Lord turned around and healed him and delivered him when he prayed for his friends. Maybe we need to start praying for people who mistreat us. He turned around and said, you're going to die and not live. Hezekiah turned away from sensations, turned away from symptoms. He turned away from sympathizing friends. He turned away from relatives. He turned away from the medical skill of his day. The only thing he could see was God, and he poured his heart out to God. Please hear me. Hear me. Why? Because Job said, O thou that hearest the cry of the afflicted. If you are afflicted right now, whether sin or sickness, if you would begin to cry out to God, he would hear your cry because he is open to the cry of the afflicted. And the Bible said in Job, and his hands make whole. If you'll cry out, you'll feel a set of hands come on you that will give you mercy, that will give you forgiveness, that will give you encouragement, that will bring healing and deliverance to you. If you understood how close you were to your miracle, you'd flip out. God is on his way to show himself strong. Did not the Bible say, Chronicles 16 and 9, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout all the earth, beholding the good and evil, to show himself strong, whose hearts are perfect towards him? Not whose lives are perfect, but whose hearts, their affections, their desires, their yearnings, their want to. He's looking to bless people. The potentate is looking to bless people this morning. And it doesn't matter what kind of negative report you got, whether from the banker, whether from the doctor, whether from the neighbors, whether from your job. I don't care. If you will turn your face away from that and just start crying out to God and saying, Lord, I've tried the best I could. I tried to be right before you. I tell you what you can do. You can get God to give you another statement. And he wept sore. He said, I don't want to die. I want to be healed. I want to be delivered. The Bible said Isaiah's walking out on the porch. He gets to the end of the porch and the king of the universe says, Isaiah, go back in and tell my boy something. I know I gave him a death, but I've been so moved by his praying. I've been so touched by his tears. I've been so activated by his sincerity and his desperation. I'm going to reverse the curse. Go back and tell him you got 15 years. I don't care what the doctors told you. I don't care what your life has told you. I don't care if your failures have driven you crazy. You can get God to give you a promise of more life and better life and holy life and spiritual life if you'll just turn your face to the wall and begin to cry out and believe him that he hears you. For he heareth the cry of the afflicted. I wish I could convince you right now. The potentate is on the prowl. He's looking to bless people. He's looking to help people. He's looking to encourage people. You got to be a praiser. You got to be expecting something to happen. It doesn't matter what kind of bad news has come your way. You can ask God for mercy, and he delights in mercy. He's rich in mercy. He's willing to forgive. He's willing to fix. He's willing to save anybody. We need people that are thankful. You need to learn how to be thankful when it looks like you ain't got nothing to be thankful about. You woke up this morning. He started you on your way. He kept your heart beating during the night. He protected you from devils and demons. I was a drunk. I had no hope. I robbed places. I told you last night I packed a gun. I've been in jail. I'm not bragging. I'm just telling you. That's where I came from. And God snatched me out. I mean, some of you right now, God needs to just snatch you. Come here. You didn't just dance in here and waltz in here and say, I think I'll join the Pentecostal church. Oh, no. The holy power of God just grabbed a hold of you and drew you into this thing. You need to tell the devil that he ain't got the last word in your life. You need to make sure that you can see God as the Lord of the impossible. He can take you from any situation and turn it around. He's the Lord of the impossible. Something impossible is going to happen. Something marvelous is fixing to happen. Something supernatural is fixing to happen. I told you last night, expectation is the birthplace for the miraculous. Something marvelous is fixing to happen. Isaiah gave Hezekiah bad news. Hezekiah wouldn't accept it. And he said, I don't want to die. And I've tried to live. And he poured his heart out. And it so moved God that God turned around and said, here's 15 years for free. Some of you right now might just need a merciful extension on your life from God. See, that's why I'm wacko. The next 2 weeks, the evil one spoke to me. Thoughts in my head. Where's your song now? Where's your praise now? You said, trust God with trouble? Can God trust you with trouble? Well, you got trouble. What are you going to do? They take me to my chair, so I go sit down. I start getting up. I start dancing. The whole church exploded. See, you can help people by an example more than you can just by giving them word. And I made it up my mind, Elder. You ain't stealing my song, and you ain't stealing my dance, and you're not stealing my joy. You are a liar, and you are the father of liars. If God be for me, it doesn't matter who or what is against me. I shall not die, but I shall live and proclaim the praises of the Lord. I am not dying in my mess. I'm coming out of my mess. I'm going to live. I'm going to be better. God is going to turn my situation around because he's the Lord of the impossible. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sins. I'll heal their land. If my people will, I will. If God has commanded human cooperation to be saved, he also requires human cooperation to be healed. Salvation doesn't just fall on you, and healing doesn't just knock you out of the chair. You got to cooperate. So the Lord has given a lot of instruction to people. Go wash in the pool of Bethesda. That guy who's blind in John 9, remember? He spits, puts the mud on his eyes. Some of you wouldn't let him put that mud on your eyes. You go to heal one guy, spit in his face. The only good thing was he didn't see it coming. This is mind-boggling to me. Go wash in the pool of Siloam. Now, is that a dirty trick, or is he trying to show us something? How's he going to find a pool? He's blind. Go wash in the pool of Siloam. He's got mud on his eyeballs. You don't think he looks stupid? You don't think when he's trying to find a pool, people are saying, boy, you look stupid. Who put the mud on your eyes? What's the matter? Why don't you go wash? See, sometimes you look dumb trying to obey God. And he turns around and he says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. Now, to me, how's he going to find a pool? He's got to ask somebody that sees. He says, hey, bud, this guy just spit in my face and put this mud on my eyes. Told me to go wash in the pool of Siloam. Maybe you haven't noticed. I can't see. Do you know where the pool is? Would you be so kind as to take me to the pool? The only way the man's going to have a miracle is if he can find somebody who can see to help him. You sit down. The only way some of these people are going to get saved in this city is the people that sake that can see would go out of their way and bring them to where they need to be. We that see owe the blind spiritually effort. So he's got to cooperate and got to go wash in the pool of Siloam. You understand? He tells you to do some crazy stuff. Does your master pay tax? Peter's always shooting off at the mouth before his brain gets in place. And he goes, oh, yeah, my master, he pays the temple tax. Sure, yeah, he pays it. And then Jesus stops him. He said, hey, Pete, people that pay tax, do the strangers pay the tax or the people that live here? He goes, oh, the strangers. He said, well, then the residents and citizens are free. Yeah. Yeah, but you just told them we paid the tax, so we don't offend them. Go down to the river here. He tells a grown man, cast a hook into the water. He didn't say bait. He said a hook. The Lord of the impossible. First fish you catch, you'll be loaded with money. You're a carpenter. You don't know nothing about the water and the sea. You want me to cast a hook into the water, and you're going to find money in his mouth to pay our taxes. Okay, I've had miracles in my life where money came back to me, where situations turned around that I thought was absolutely impossible. Because all of us at times in life are forced to face situations that says, that's impossible. Tell Naaman to go dip 7 times in the Jordan. What's the water got to do with me getting? And his argument is with the instructions. Sometimes God will give you a miracle when you have little faith, but you have great obedience. He's on the shore. They just fished all night. He's standing there and says, got any meat, children? And they can't make out who it is. And he said, no, we fished all night. We've taken nothing. Now watch what he says. Cast on the right side of the ship, and thou shalt find. They throw the net over. So many fish, it almost sinks the boat. The minute that happens, John says, it's the Lord. And Peter says, how do you know? He said, who else ever asked you to try again where you just failed? Who else ever asked you to try one more time when you failed the previous time? Would you consider turning your face to your spiritual wall and asking God to forgive you, to help you, to extend to you a gift? If he gave that to Hezekiah, then what worked for Hezekiah will work for us this morning. Yes, sir. Right now. 43:25.
I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions.
Yes.
For mine own sake.
For my own sake.
And will not remember thy sins.
Go.
Put me in remembrance.
Stop. The Lord said, why don't you remind me about my promises?
Huh.
Why don't you rehearse my promises to you?
Yes, sir.
You're in trouble. You're hurting. You're sick. Whatever. Put me in remembrance what I've promised to do for you.
Yes, sir.
In the day that you seek me with your whole heart, saith the Lord, in that day you shall find me. Put me in remembrance of that. When you ask, you're supposed to receive. And when you seek, you're supposed to find. When you knock, it's supposed to be open. Put me in remembrance of what I promised to you.
Yes, sir.
And the Lord was ready to heal me. Well, what was the difference between the bad message of you're going to die and he was ready? He's waiting for Hezekiah to respond.
Right.
Are you going to accept the bad report, or are you going to appeal to the God of glory and see if he won't change the report? Did you hear me enough?
Right.
That whatever you're facing, how impossible it may be, it's not impossible with God. When the Lord cast the devil out of that demonized boy, and Jesus said to the father, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. He said, I believe. Help my unbelief. Before that, he said, if thou canst do anything. The issue is not what God can do. The issue is, do you believe?
Right.
When he turned around and said, if you can do anything, help me. He said, no, I'm not the problem. You're the problem.
Right.
If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believes. He said, I believe. Help my unbelief.
Yes.
Right now, do you believe that if you ask God to forgive you, he will forgive you? That's why we require repentance.
Right.
Do you believe that if you get water baptized in Jesus' name, all your sins will be washed away?
Yes.
Do you believe if you will throw open your heart to him and ask him, he will fill you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Do you believe that if you come to him with raw faith and raw trust, even if you're afraid, that he will heal? Remember, his hands make whole. He heareth the cry of the afflicted.
Yes, sir.
Okay? If you've got any situation in your life right now that is impossible, looks impossible, or seems impossible, and you believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of the impossible, he can fix your marriage, he can take your kids off drugs, he can help your life, he can turn things around, I'd like you to leave where you are and come up here, and we're going to have a corporate prayer.
Yes,
and we're going to ask God to give us some answers for what seems to be impossible situations. It looks impossible. Sure, just like it did at Lazarus' grave. He's dead 4 days. It doesn't matter. You're facing something that looks impossible, but with God, nothing is impossible. And it doesn't matter how many times you've prayed about it and how many times you tried and it hasn't worked. We're going to try again. We're going to appeal again. Remember, folks, Elijah was given a divine promise. Show yourself to Ahab and I'll send rain. Guess what? He showed himself to Ahab and there was no rain. Why? Because sometimes you got to pray the promise into reality. Now you've got a promise of mercy. Now believe God for it. And pray for it right now. Pray for it right now. Pray for it right now.
The cross. said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world."
Baptism, then what? Baptism is a burial in water for accountable beings into the remission of sins, for salvation, to get into Christ, to become a new creature, to get into the one body. Then, walk in the new life, study and grow, become a servant of righteousness, keep self pure, be an example, have faith in God, follow Jesus, put first things first, resist temptation, be faithful, and be fruitful.
What we do in life? Echoes in eternity.